Brendan Burns, Scott Hunter, and Mandy Whaley.
Wow. So thanks for coming today. It's great to be back in person at Build for the first time in many, many years. And so we're here today to talk about how to build cloud-native intelligent apps on Azure. Primarily, we're going to talk about containers is the big thing. We never talked about ourselves. That slide disappeared.
Scott.
So I'm Scott Hunter. I work in the Azure Developer Experience team. We build the Azure SDKs. We build the tools for Azure and VS and VS Code. And we build a lot of the developer services.
I'm Mandy Whaley. I lead our Azure DevTools team.
I'm Brendan Burns. I lead the team in Microsoft Azure that focuses on cloud native and open source computing.
And so we thought we'd start off and talk about what is a cloud native application. And in our cases, really the only things we really care about are going to be containers, APIs, microservices. This is primarily a microservice kind of talk. But you know, as you build apps using those technologies, you're really trying to build apps that can be very resilient, they can be manageable, and observable. But what do you think, Mandy?
I also think about that a cloud-native application is using capabilities that are only available in the cloud. Like blue-green deployments would be a good example of that. Brendan?
Yeah, I mean, and I think that one of the major things when we think about cloud-native applications is that shift of APIs from being focused around infrastructure that you might find in your data center, and instead focused around ideas that a developer might think about, like a rollout or an instance, a replica of an application.
Cool. And
so with that, you know, let's just talk about a couple of the different types of apps that you can build, you know, that are cloud-native. And we think of modernization is a big one of these, and an example of modernization for us is Walmart is an example of a e-commerce company that has a bunch of microservices in Azure, and it's designed to scale their store for the holiday rushes. Today, we're going to build an AI app on the stage, or show an AI app on the stage, running on all of our technologies. You know, we've all played with ChatGPT or one of the co-pilots. You saw Satya this morning and experienced a lot of that. SaaS is another thing that people build with cloud-native technologies. Finstra is an example of a financial service SaaS. And what they are is they set up the APIs that power a bunch of banks around the world. When it comes to like geo-distributed applications, I think of Domino's Pizza as an example here. They have 20,000 stores around the world, and they run their back office for those stores on Azure. Siemens is a great example of a running app anywhere. You know, they have healthcare products at hospitals and stuff like that that have to work both on local networks and work in the cloud. And then finally, when you think of things like real time, there's no better example than something like Bosch, who builds tons of connected devices that can be managed and updated and monitored all through Azure. And so these are some of the big categories that we think about for these types of apps. Today, all apps start with code. And so I'm going to go and jump over and look at some code here real quick. And what I've got here is I've got a repo, and we're going to actually make this repo available at the end of the talk for anybody that wants to try this stuff themselves. I do want to call out a special thing about the repo here, though. If I look at my repo, and Mandy's going to talk about this a little bit later on, it's got an infra folder inside of it. And that's because it's using it supports our AZD, which is our Azure Developer CLI, as a way of deploying it to the cloud. And why is that important? If I come up here and I look at my portal, we've always had the ability for you to, you know, obviously pull a GitHub repo and publish that to the cloud. What about a more complicated app? In our case, a cloud-native app. It's going to have multiple parts. It's going to use multiple services. We've never had a great way of building those apps until we built the Azure Developer CLI. In this case, what I can do is I can come to the Azure portal, and there's some samples here on the screen that I could just click and get started right away if I wanted to. Or if I have my own code, I can just go to the portal, and I can say, I'm going to grab the Brady Gaster organization. I'm going to grab our repo here, and I will select the main branch. And then what's going to happen is you're going to see it says it's analyzing the repository. So what it's doing is it's going and looking to see if the assets exist in that repository for us to actually publish this application to Azure. And what it's going to do is it's going to find that infra folder. And when it finds that infra folder, it's going to know that it can use AZD to basically deploy the application in the cloud. And what it's going to do is it's going to go and put a GitHub action in my system. And after it puts that GitHub action in my system, it will then kick the action off and run that AZD to deploy the application. So, and we'll get back to this app in a little bit. So, you know, the next thing is tools and frameworks. And most people don't think of Microsoft. They probably think of us as a .NET company. You know, we actually build our own OpenJDK that we provide for our Azure customers. And we've actually contributed things to like ARM64 support for Windows, ARM64 support for Mac came from us. We have a team. We have the author of Python works for us and has been doing a lot of work recently to make Python a lot faster. Obviously, we do .NET as well. And so tools and frameworks are a big part of this as well. Mandy's going to come on a little bit later and talk about some of the tools that we use for this. And then you have to have a great cloud platform as well. And so in this case, we think of the cloud platform. We are also one of the only, we are the only cloud company that's also a security company. And so security is a big part of building cloud-native applications. You want to make sure your code is secure. It's our latest packages. You want to make sure that you're in a cloud platform that has security. And then, of course, apps need data. They need APIs. They need messaging. And we have tons of services in Azure for this. And, of course, we wrap the whole thing up with, you know, Visual Studio Code, and GitHub, and Azure DevOps as ways of adding, getting your code to cloud. So we've got a great cloud platform here. We're the only company in the world, too, I would say, that has all those components. It builds the tools, the cloud, and a bunch of the frameworks to do that. And then, of course, on top of that, how are you going to run your cloud-native containers? We have two amazing offerings. We have AKS, Azure Kubernetes Service, and we have Azure Container Apps. And so I'm going to talk about Azure Container Apps, and Brendan's going to come up and talk about AKS as well. And so we're showing here a kind of a scale from simplicity all the way to control. And in many cases, as a dev, I just want to get going right away. And so one of the cool things about Azure Container Apps is it's fast as you can go. If you have a container on your local machine, you can just push a button, and we'll code to cloud that thing right into Azure, and you've got your container running in Azure. We are serverless, which means you can scale this thing to zero. So we have two ways of scaling, scale to zero and scale to idle. Idle means it'll come back up really quickly, and you're paying a very small price while we keep it idle. And scale to zero, you're paying nothing. We have embedded app patterns. And what I mean by that is the slide's going to, in a second, is going to show things like Kada and Dapper. They're built into container apps. You can use them in Kubernetes as well, but you're going to configure those and hook them up yourselves. And so we kind of think that whole stack of things means more dev, less ops. But part of our talk today is also about we're going to run the app both in ACA and on AKS as well. And I'll turn it over to Brendan to talk about AKS.
Yeah, and I think the really great thing that both Scott and I are really driving towards is this idea that it really is a continuum. And that the same tools like Dapper and Kada and otherwise are available to you no matter where you are running your application. So it's not just even about the container. It's actually about the application environments themselves. But when we think about the Azure Kubernetes Service, obviously the core of that is an industry standard open source project, which means there's really great portability, not just between different services in Azure, but actually across clouds to private clouds. I run, you know, the same containers in my basement as I do up in the Azure cloud. And then also along with that industry standardization comes access to an open source ecosystem of software vendors and other projects that are developed and may even be developed by people who are interested in deploying them to other clouds or other locations, and you can use them on Azure as well. So it's really that access to the whole world moving forward with cloud-native computing. And then finally, of course, because the Azure Kubernetes Service runs within the virtual machines in your subscription, all of the enterprise policies, all of the various network configurations, security monitoring that your CISO or whoever's in charge of setting up an Azure environment wants to make sure is true for your entire Azure environment applies even to modern cloud-native development in the Azure Kubernetes Service.
Cool. Thanks, Brendan. And you obviously, as I said earlier, Dapper is there to make your apps portable, both on your local machine or between Azure Container Apps and Kubernetes. Kada is our event-driven scaler, as I said. But a big thing we also want to mention is this is not the .NET cloud. This technology supports all the languages. We support all the languages, and that's a big important thing for us. And with that, you know, we couldn't be a talk at Build without having a little bit of AI as well. And so this is showing the portfolio of AI services that we provide in Azure today. But today I want to focus on a couple of these. We're going to use cognitive search as a way to look at some of our own documents and make them available to OpenAI. We're going to use the speech technology so I can actually talk to the app. Just like I could type, I can also talk to the app. And then we're going to use OpenAI to actually let me use human text to query the documents in my organization. And so with that, the app is literally, it's going to take my data. So imagine you've got your own company, and you've got documents. In our case, we're going to be a healthcare company. We're going to take all of our documents and explain the healthcare plans and stuff like that. We're going to scan them. We're going to first put them in Azure storage. Then we're going to take cognitive search, run it against those documents. It's going to produce an index. And we're then going to take that index, and we're going to shove that index into the AI tech. And then we're going to have an application where you can basically just ask questions about this. And I like to think of this like, imagine if you want to go find what your deductible is. It might be hard to do that, because you have to go search through the website and go find stuff. It'd be great just to be able to ask that. So with that, I will jump back over here. And our application should hopefully be deployed. So you can see here that it shows that everything succeeded and went up in the cloud. And I will talk about this a little bit more in a second. Normally, an app like this would take about 38 minutes to deploy in Azure. This takes about 6 minutes. And we're showing you a view of your application where you just primarily see your application. So here's my web front end here. Here's my container registry. Here's my Redis cache for caching. Here's my App Insights and Log Analytics for looking at my app. But let's actually just go to the app. So let's click the web front end. And I can click the link to actually open the app right here. And I can ask it a question. And so this is just a simple app using our data. So this is not going to, can't search the public web. It can only search the stuff that we've actually fed it from the application. And I'm going to be brave and try this live. What is my deductible? So there you see, I was actually able to use our speech APIs to let me actually ask the question with my voice. We converted that into text. We then went and found out what the deductibles are. And even more important, you can see here, there's a link right here in the application to the actual document that we found the deductible in. And I think that's important. So it's not that we're making up stuff on the fly, that this is your documents, and from your documents, we can actually go and show you exactly where that came from. So with that, this is kind of a diagram of the application. And you can see we've got your code. We're running that container in Azure Container Apps. And you can see we've got storage, Redis cache for caching. Brendan's going to come on a little bit later on, and we're going to do some load testing, showing how we can really hit the application and put some work on it. As I said, this is focusing on container apps. But we're going to run this exact same demo on AKS in just a few minutes. And so let me talk about a couple of the other cool things that are happening in container apps that I'm really excited about. First off, we now have support for what we call dedicated and consumption. So consumption is where you don't really care about the hardware. Hey, I might want my machine to wake up at some time and run for a few minutes, and I only want to pay for the app while it's actually running. While dedicated means I actually own the hardware, and I'm going to pay for it the entire time. We can now mix and match these together in a single container app environment. So you can actually have some workloads you don't really have to have hardware you determine on. And you can have some apps that are, I want this much memory, this much CPU, all of this stuff. In preview today at Build, we now have support for VNets. It's been a huge ask for us for container apps. So for people that want to control more than just, does this application have ingress or egress, and in what ports, now you can configure your entire network however you want to do it. Really another cool feature is jobs. So this is something that just came out today. And what jobs lets you do is, you know, what if you have something like, my example is, I want to send a welcome email to anybody that signed up to my site. And so once a day, the job will kick off. We'll boot your container up. We'll run your code. And as soon as your code's done, we'll put the container back down. And you only paid for the 2 minutes or 3 minutes that happened. So your jobs can be triggered based on events, messaging, time of day, whatever. So it's a really cool capability that we have in container apps. Add-ons is what made that deployment happen so fast today. Normally, what I would do is I would actually, if I'm doing a production application, I want to use an Azure Redis cache because I want to have something that's managed with an SLA. I would probably use Azure Postgres for my data. I want that to be managed. But as a dev, I don't want to wait for all that stuff. And so add-ons lets you choose from a curated list of these services that we can boot up right inside of your container app. And then when you're ready to, with either a command line or a portal action, you can switch that from the local version inside of your container apps to the version I'd recommend running for a production app that's a managed service. Code to cloud. What I showed earlier was a new experience we added to the portal. I mentioned before that today, the code to cloud that we have in the portal is you like go to something like an app service, you point it at your repo. It's a single app. But most of our applications actually end up being multi-parts. You might have a database. You might have a cache. You might have a front end and a back end. And so this basically says any repo that we can go and analyze, we can then go and run the right commands to deploy that to Azure for you. And our hope is that we actually make all the samples that we have for Azure support this. So you can either do it from the portal or from the command line. I'll do it from command line in a little bit. And then secondly, we want to give you that view of your application. You know, Azure is a pile of resources. And it gives a resource view. I'm a dev. I want to see my front end, my back end, my data. And I want to see them in that kind of view. And so we're working to make those views in the portal much, much better. And that's what I was showing earlier. And with that, I'm going to hand it over to Mandy to talk about tools.
Thank you. Hi, I'm Mandy Whaley, and I lead our Azure DevTools team. And our job is to help make your job as a developer easier. We build tools and libraries that can help any developer working in any language, building for any platform, be successful on Azure. I'm really excited to share some of the new things that we're working on with you today. One of those is our Azure tools for Visual Studio and Visual Studio Code. These tools help give you quick access to your Azure resources and your GitHub Action workflows right in your editor or IDE where you're coding. We're also building application templates. And these application templates can help you get up and running on Azure fast with common application stacks in different languages, Python, JavaScript, Java, and .NET. When you're developing for the cloud, automation and integration with your CI/CD pipeline is really critical. So we're also working on new ways to help you stand up deployment pipelines with just a few simple steps, and also specific GitHub actions to help you work with Azure services and make these integrations really seamless. And our Azure SDK libraries help you integrate the capabilities of Azure into your application in your favorite language. These libraries are built to help you with common tasks like authentication, security, doing retries, and they're also built to be familiar in your favorite language. So if you're a Python developer working in our Python libraries, they will feel Pythonic. Same goes if you're a JavaScript developer or a .NET developer working in your language libraries. One of our main goals is to help you focus on your code. And when you're developing for the cloud, some of the things you need to access most frequently are your cloud resources and your deployment pipelines. So we're constantly working to bring those experiences in closer to where you're doing your code. Our tools can help you do things like build and debug containers locally, push images to Azure Container Registry or Azure Container Apps. We also have tools to help you develop, debug, and deploy your Kubernetes applications. And we're always working to help get you quick access to logging and monitoring information to help you out when you're troubleshooting. If you're using GitHub Actions for your deployment pipelines, it's great to be able to monitor the progress of those right from within your editor. And using the Azure Developer CLI, we have some new ways to stand up these deployment pipelines in just a couple steps. Some of the GitHub actions that can help you do things with specific Azure services include things like create an AKS cluster, or deploy to Kubernetes, or build and deploy for Azure Container Apps. I want to take a closer look at some of these tools over here at our demo station. All right, so I am here in VS Code. I think I had one more click. I'm here in VS Code, and I want to take a look at a couple things. Scott started off with our repo, which we then used the portal experience to deploy to Azure. I've got that same repo open in VS Code, and I also have our Azure tools installed. I'm going to use the group by resource group option, because this will help me focus in on just the resources that were deployed for this application. I can also use this new focus feature, which really can help me focus in specifically on the application that I'm working with. You can see we've got our container apps environment, and inside of that, we also have our Redis cache container, and then the container that's running our application for the enterprise chat. I can use this to dive in and get straight to the logs and do other things like that. Our application also uses Azure Storage. And using the Azure Storage extension, I can go right into our blob storage. And I can actually see these are the PDFs that Scott was showing that helps the enterprise chat application know about our policies, our procedures, what the deductible was when he was asking those questions. When it was bringing back those documents, those are what I can actually interact with through the tools. This is just a great example of how we're working to bring your cloud resources closer into where you're doing your coding. The next thing I wanted to show is that the GitHub Actions extension is really great because you can see the workflows that are associated with this repo. And if you notice here, these are the same steps in the workflow that we saw on the completed screen when Scott was showing that the deployment had finished. So I will actually make a change, and I'm going to save. And I will actually be brave and do this live commit. This is enabling a sort control if we wanted to do that. I'm going to commit, sync. And then if we head back to the GitHub Actions extension, we'll start to see that GitHub workflow run, hopefully soon. There we go. So we can see it's kicked off, it's running, and we can actually monitor that as it goes through all of the different steps while we keep working in VS Code. I'm going to head back to the slides because I want to share a few more things. Another one of our goals is to help you get started fast. And for this, we're building application templates. We're building application templates for common application stacks in different languages. And we're also building application templates for specific use cases, like this enterprise chat application that we're taking a look at today. Each application template includes the actual application code, and the infrastructure as code files in both Bicep and Terraform. These files help you provision and configure the Azure resources needed to run the application. You can deploy the app templates through the portal experience that we saw at the beginning of this session, or through the Azure Developer CLI, which you can run from any terminal. We can see an example of what that experience looks like here. You initialize your template, log into Azure, run AZD up, and then it asks you for your subscription, your location in Azure, and then the tool begins to package your application, provision the resources, and deploy everything up to Azure. Along the way, you'll get back links that help you monitor the resources as they're getting provisioned and coming up, and a link at the end that you can go to see your running application up running in the cloud in Azure. The template that we're working with today is an example of an intelligent application. This enterprise chat agent is using our Azure OpenAI service and our recently released Azure OpenAI SDKs. We have these libraries in .NET, JavaScript, and Python. And what's great about these libraries is they're designed to help you work across both Azure OpenAI and OpenAI, which can make your development process really seamless. This is an area that we're really actively working on. We have lots of new releases, new updates to these libraries, new application templates coming out, and we'd love to hear from you about what would help you build these kinds of applications. What do you need in the libraries? What kind of application templates would help you the most? We have two application templates right now that are available for you to try out. One is the enterprise chat that we're using today, and we have another one to help you get started building ChatGPT plugins. I do want to go back to the tools and show you a few more things. All right. So I'm going to start in the code, and I wanted to share some of what's in a template. I'm actually going to go to GitHub and refresh what we saw in the template there. So this is the template for the application we're using today. You can see, and this is common for all of our application templates, you get a diagram helping you understand how the application's built, the services that are involved, how it's put together, some information about the actual use case and application, everything you need to run locally, and then everything that you need to AZD up and get it running in Azure. If I head back to VS Code, we can take a look at what is in the application. In this application, we have an app folder. This is where the actual application, the web application, everything lives. And then we also have the infra folder. In this case, we're using Bicep to do the infrastructure as code files. You can also use Terraform if you are more familiar with Terraform or that's what your team uses. That's a choice that's up to you. For Bicep, we modularize the Bicep for each Azure service. This also makes it easy to start learning Bicep. If it's something you want to get deeper into, these templates can help you learn more about that and start working with more infrastructure as code. Another great thing is that our Azure extensions will recognize that this is one of our application templates. And so you get access to the AZD commands right from this menu, or of course you can run them from the command line. I wanted to take a closer look at where we're using some of the Azure OpenAI SDKs in this application. So I'm going to dive in here. And in this part of the application, you can see where we are creating our OpenAI client. This application uses several different .NET SDKs. We're using Azure Storage, we're using the Form Recognizer with document analysis, and we're using the Azure OpenAI client. What's great about this is that you can use patterns that you're already familiar with from working in Azure to interact with Azure OpenAI. For example, you can authenticate using managed identity and AAD, which gives you added security beyond just using an API key. I also wanted to take a look at where we are using the OpenAI text completion service. And this is a great example of where the libraries really help you out. So in our application, we're used to having these really nice streaming text fluid responses like we see in ChatGPT applications. And in this case, the library is taking care of all of that for you. And the developer just needs to use the async await pattern that they're probably already familiar with. So I hope you get a chance to try out some of these new tools and libraries. We'd love to hear from you what will help you the most, and I can't wait to see what you're going to build. I'm going to hand it back to Scott to continue on with our app.
You can come up too, Brendan, if you want. Thanks, Mandy. You know, we talked earlier about, I'll give you the clicker because you're
right.
Next. If you want to click once for us, this is, you know, we talked earlier about, hey, we built that app and it was running on Azure Container Apps. The same technology, the AZD that was powering that from the portal, we can use that same technology to power right from the command line as well. So here I am in VS Code, and I can just do AZD up. And what that's going to do is that's going to start running. You can see it's starting to do work here, creating a deployment plan. And it will take that same application we just ran in ACA, and it will get that same app running in Azure Container Apps, I mean Azure Kubernetes Service.
That's right.
And so I'm going to turn it over to Brendan to talk about AKS.
Cool. All right. You know, I think Mandy did a really great job of showing all of the different ways that extensions within VS Code enable us to get a great perspective on our applications, better insight into how we're using Azure. I wanted to highlight the Kubernetes extension that we have here inside of VS Code. And unlike, in some sense, some of the other extensions that have been seen so far, this extension is actually available to you no matter where you're running Kubernetes, staying true, I think, to our open source roots and the notion that this is something that we're building for the broader cloud industry. This extension, if you install it into VS Code, it gives you insight into any Kubernetes cluster that you have anywhere in the world. Of course, it works really well with the Azure Kubernetes Service with a lot of nice integration with the other Azure extensions that we've got installed in VS Code. You can see here a tree view of the cluster that I have, and if I dive into that cluster, I can take a look and see, for example, the various namespaces that I'm running. You can see some of the system pods that are there, as well as our application pods. We can go into the workloads here and into the deployments. And once this application finishes deploying, inside of that deployments inside of that deployments tree view, you'd be able to see your running application and even take steps like being able to gain access into a terminal inside of your pod or do secure port forwarding to get access to maybe a web service that hasn't been exposed on the internet. So there's a lot of different capabilities to make it easier inside of that application to, or inside of your application development environment to interact with the running service in that's been deployed out to the Kubernetes cluster. Speaking of the Azure Kubernetes Service, I wanted to go through a bunch of the really exciting things that we're bringing available to Kubernetes today. One of the most interesting things that we're bringing is a managed Istio add-on. One of the things that has happened in the cloud native community is that there's been an open source foundation that's been created called the Cloud Native Compute Foundation. And the important part of that is that it allows a bunch of different companies, potentially even competitors, to come together and collaborate on these projects, knowing that the investments that they're making collaboratively will be beneficial not just to them, but to the entire community. So when Istio Service Mesh, which is used for interconnecting microservices, was recently donated to the Cloud Native Compute Foundation, we took the step of getting involved in the Istio project and bringing it to the Azure Kubernetes Service so that you can have a managed solution for Service Mesh using this popular Istio project available to you within the Azure Kubernetes Service. Now, in addition to building applications, we obviously want to secure applications. And in many cases, securing those applications involves ensuring that code that is running can't affect other sorts of containers. Now, it seems, I think, sometimes when people see containers, they think of them as a security boundary. But in fact, actually, the only real security boundary that you can rely on is a virtualized or a virtual machine layer of security. Not necessary for a lot of our container applications where different development teams are developing, but they basically trust each other. But sometimes you want to run code that perhaps someone else has developed, or maybe as a user has contributed to you as part of a customization. So we're really excited that we've been able to work with the Kata project to bring Kata containers to the AKS service, meaning that you can run select pods, or even all your pods if you wanted to, run all of your containers within a virtual machine isolation boundary as well, nested inside of your Azure virtual machine. So every single container that's running in your cluster can have that secure boundary of the virtual machine interface. Additionally, when we're thinking about security, reliability, and resiliency is the next thing you might be thinking about, we've worked very closely with the Azure Backup Service to give cloud-native support for the Azure Backup Service so that you can back up both the control plane in your Kubernetes cluster as well as the data within your cluster as well. And again, it's sort of a bit of a broken record, but coming back to our open source roots, this is based on a CNCF project called Valero that does a lot of the backup work within that service. And then finally, I think over the time that I've been in Azure, one of the great trends has been an increased focus from all the different parts of Azure on cloud native computing. And so we're really excited that the storage team within Azure Storage has brought forth Azure Container Native Storage. It has really fast disk attach and detach times so that if your pods are moving around because you're scaling up or scaling down or because a machine happened to fail, you can know that your application is still going to stay responsive as the disks sort of move from one machine to another across the cluster. Speaking of things moving quickly around, one of the things that's been a pain point for Kubernetes from the start, honestly, has been the fact that numerous releases come out every single year, and especially in regulated industries or other places where you need to certify your environments, the pain of keeping up with the latest Kubernetes version is a very real problem for a lot of development teams. And so that's why we've been really excited to work to bring to fruition a long-term support branch for the Kubernetes project. We've been developing this for the Azure Kubernetes Service, but we are also developing it in conjunction with the broader Kubernetes community. At this point, we are going to commit to a 2-year long-term support arrangement for a specific version of Kubernetes. In this case, it's the 1.2.7 version. And after that 2-year, we will come up with a new long-term support version. This means that you can commit to a single version within the Azure Kubernetes Service and stay on it with full support, with full reliability for security and major critical bug patches. Thank you. Oh, wow. See, it's viral. But it is really painful. And so I think that it's really great that we've been able to do this. And I think even more importantly, what we've been able to do is really jumpstart the conversation in the community that had been kind of there since the beginning, but had kind of lingered and not really made a lot of progress. And our willingness to step forward and say, hey, we're going to contribute engineers, we're going to contribute, and we're just going to go do this, and you can come with us, has really, I think, put a lot of energy back into the system. I think we may really see a true long-term support version for the entire open source project, no matter where you're running Kubernetes, happening in the next year or two. And of course, we're deeply involved with our upstream open source teams in making that happen. The last thing I wanted to highlight is the Kubernetes Fleet Manager. I think one of the interesting things we've discovered, unexpectedly, I think, within Kubernetes has been that, you know, we thought people would run maybe one cluster per region, one cluster per zone. In fact, we see many customers with hundreds or even thousands of clusters. And managing all those clusters consistently, obviously, is a bit of a pain point. And so with Fleet Manager, you can control multiple collections of clusters, deploy applications out, and then do things like what we've announced recently with the CADA carbon-aware scheduling, where using Fleet and carbon-aware scheduling, you can have a workload that actually moves between data centers, between regions, depending on the carbon footprint of that particular region at that particular time. And so that really enables a lot of our customers to achieve some of their sustainability goals. And I think it's a great example of how we can, in Azure, enable our customers to do more. I wanted to move from there to something that Mandy mentioned earlier, which is the Azure Load Testing Service. So Azure Load Testing is, and I'm going to go over here and do a demo of it. Azure Load Testing is a service that allows you to run load tests, obviously, against your application. But what I want to actually show you is how you can use the Azure Load Testing Service to actually figure out the right way to configure your application. Because, of course, we were talking about sustainability. That's an important goal for a lot of people. Efficiency is also a really important goal right now. Sometimes when we deploy our applications, the way they're configured is sort of, well, it just sort of worked that way, and we don't know if there's a better configuration. So I want to take a look here at the at a GitHub action that we've developed. Now, we're using a matrix build right here. And what this matrix is doing, typically, sometimes maybe we think about a matrix across operating systems or a matrix across, you know, runtime versions. What we're actually matrixing across is deployment configurations. So we have either 3 or 5 replicas, either 1/4 of a core or 1/2 a core, either 256 megabytes of RAM or 512 megabytes of RAM, and we're going to have a matrix of all of those different characteristics. And then what we're going to do is we're actually going to go and run a load test against all of those different versions. So over here on the left, in this GitHub action, you can see all of these different variations and all of the different load tests that are running on them. So that's useful that we've been able to sort of do that Cartesian product of load tests in parallel on the GitHub Actions interface. But what's even more interesting is we go back and in the Azure Load Test dashboard, we can actually compare these runs together. And so here you can actually see we're comparing a run with 3 replicas and 1/4 of a core, 5 replicas and 1/4 of a core, or 5 replicas and 1/2 a core each. And if we go down here, obviously, as we would expect, this teal line where we have the most replicas with the most resources is the fastest. But actually, maybe we've worked with our user design interface folks, and they've said, you know what? Actually, people really only notice if we're slower than about 150 milliseconds. And so in fact, this pink line here that manages to stay under 150 milliseconds as we simulate 100 users running against it, and 1,000 requests per second, this pink line satisfies our application requirements, but uses half as many resources, right? And so by being able to use the Azure Load Testing to generate that matrix, we can actually find a better configuration than maybe the optimal one, but one that is much more efficient and saves us money while still ensuring that our users are happy. So I think that's a great example of how we can use automation, not just to do continuous delivery, but actually to investigate and understand better details of our applications themselves. Now, in the core of that Azure Load Testing Service is an open source project called JMeter. Fun trivia fact is that the JMeter project is actually the very first project that I was a maintainer of way back in 1999. So it's fun to see that come full circle and be within Azure today. And actually, one of the things that I think Azure's really been focused on a lot is taking really great open source projects and turning them into managed solutions for you. Because oftentimes, while we think of open source as being free, like maybe a free beer at the end of the conference day, it turns out it's much more like free as in puppy, and you need to care and feed it every single day. And so allowing Azure to take responsibility for those projects and ensure that they're up to date, that they're patched, that we're contributing to the communities and that they're healthy ensures that you can be successful with popular open source projects. For example, the Azure Monitor for Prometheus. Prometheus is sort of the industry standard for monitoring in cloud native applications at this point. So we're really excited to be able to support Prometheus. And also, we're really excited to be able to support open source independent software vendors, or ISVs, with the Kubernetes Apps Marketplace. Because it's great that Azure is supporting a bunch of open source, but actually, we also want to ensure that open source startups and other companies that are developing open source have a marketplace to sell to our customers as well. And so if you're building a containerized application, whether it's open source or not, you can use the Kubernetes Apps Marketplace to sell into the Azure Kubernetes Service, as well as into Azure Arc-connected Kubernetes clusters. All right, and with that, I think we're bringing Scott and Mandy, everybody, back up onto the stage to bring us home, I guess.
Yeah, I think we want to come back down to our job is to make sure that with Dapper and CADA and AZD and VS Code and the tools extensions we have, you can basically build an app either using container apps or AKS, same tools, same support across the board. Choose the product that's the right product for you. As I said before, Azure Container Apps is more of the getting started fast, and AKS is going to be more the industry standard. You want access to those Kubernetes APIs and stuff like that. They're both great choices, and it doesn't matter what language you write in.
Yeah,
support them all.
I think one of the wonderful things that's happened in the cloud native community lately, or really in the whole history of it, is that we've built abstractions in a variety of places, whether it's the container as a runnable thingy that Mandy's tools can target, or that we know how to run, or the fact that the container can contain any language, any configuration. Those sorts of abstractions really enable us to do a great job of building for anyone, anywhere.
Definitely.
Cool.
And we find most companies I go to now have mixes of languages.
Oh my God, yeah. So like so many people, not even mixes of languages, but mixes of runtimes. And I think one of the things we've really seen is people sort of saying like, well, this team developed in Functions, and this team developed in Kubernetes, right. And like, how do we bring them together? And I think one of the other commitments that we have here is that we really want you not to have to choose a programming environment for your entire company. We want you to be able to choose the pattern that works best for that app, have them interoperate really well together, no matter where they land, and no matter what language they're written in. So,
yeah,
cool. All right.
Big things here, I would say there's lots of sessions on containers and tools and frameworks this week. I think the biggest one is there's a link here if you want to grab the same app we showed today. You can grab that app, pull it down. It's got full instructions of how to, you have to register for OpenAI as well to get access to that.
Yes.
But once you've done that, you can actually run that exact app as we showed it. You can put your own documents in it if you want to and try it out. So I would say, try it out.
Yeah, go try it. Thanks for being here.
Thank you very much.
That's great.
Thanks, folks.
Thanks.
Thank you.